Sunday drive home. But first, look at the sunset from this morning. It's just me against the world. John chapter 4, Jesus has been down in the south in Judea, and he comes back up north to Galilee, and he goes to Cana. There must have been some family relations in Cana. That's where the wedding was, where Mary was like almost in charge of the feast. And Jesus did his first sign, turns water into wine. And there's a man in Capernaum, which is like 15 miles away, on this over to the east on the Sea of Galilee. Capernaum's on the west side of the Sea of Galilee, but it's east of Cana. And this man, this is a nobleman, probably a soldier or some sort of official in Herod's castle. And he hears that Jesus is there, and so he goes to find him, and he says, "My son is sick and dying." Jesus says, "You only believe if you see signs." And the man doesn't even respond to Jesus. He says, "My son is dying." He's got one thing on his mind. Come and heal him. So this man wants Jesus to come from Cana to Capernaum because he thinks that if Jesus is there, he can heal his boy. If he's there, he's got to be there. Martha, remember when Lazarus died, his sister Martha came when Jesus came to Bethany 4 days later, and she says, "If you would have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. If you were just to be here," that's what... want Jesus to be here. But Jesus is going to prove that he can work miracles at a long distance. And so he says to the man, "Your son will live." And the man goes home, and this is maybe part of it for us to, at least I think about this, is that the man has to go home with nothing but a word. He can't see if his son is better or not. And he finds out the next day on the way home when the servants meet him halfway on the road. And when did he get better? And they say, right at this time. And the man said, that's when Jesus said he'll live. And so as soon as Jesus spoke the word, boom, instantly, whoosh, the boy's better. But the man doesn't see it yet. So the Lord is always setting things up this way. There's a gap between the things that we hear and the things that we see. And we hear it first. Like we talked about this, I think, a couple weeks ago on the Sunday drive home. It's like thunder and lightning, but in reverse. We see the lightning and then we hear the thunder. But the way it is with the Lord is that it's we hear the thunder as word, and then we see the lightning of the resurrection. The hearing comes before the seeing, so that we walk by faith, not by sight. Now, until sight gives way to, till hearing and faith give way to sight on the last day. Oh, what a day that is going to be. Now, it occurs to me that a little bit of the sermon this morning, that for whatever reason, when we read the Bible, it seems very flat to us. Like the characters there, because they're not... I don't know why. I mean, maybe it's because the devil. It's maybe because of the difference between the way the Bible was written and the way that modern fiction is written. So that in modern fiction, you have all this time spent on character development. And you want to hear the ins and outs of how it is with people and their thinking, you know, all the internal thoughts and everything, and the Bible just gives it to us real simple. It's a man from Capernaum. He came to Jesus. He said, come heal my son. Jesus says he'll live, and he turns around and goes home. I mean, there. And so it seems very flat to us, and so we have to work a little bit with our imagination to realize this, at least this, that that the people in the Bible were real people with real families and real troubles. This guy, this Capernaum nobleman, maybe he'd done well for himself. I mean, he was a nobleman, he was an officer. And yet he had a family, had a wife, and he had at least one child. But in his home there in Capernaum, it was full of sickness and despair and trouble, kind of in desperation. They'd no doubt tried everything that they could have so that this boy would live, and that it all had failed. And so here he is on death's door, and then this. Could think about this, that this father is willing to leave the deathbed of his son. I just have to think that if I was at the deathbed of one of my children, that I would be really hard pressed to leave that place. And yet this man leaves the deathbed of his son to go for a day to find Jesus. He's got to think that when he left his boy there in his bed, that the chances were most likely that he would come back and find him dead. Maybe even already buried. They didn't wait around that long in those days. Still, he goes to find Jesus. This is good. It's good for us to remember this, that the people in the Bible were real people with real families and real jobs and real histories and real homes that ate real food, and they had real sicknesses and real problems and real sins, real fights with the devil. They really died and were buried. They were just as real as you and I are. They needed saving, and they had trouble. This is the point. They had trouble. The devil likes to think that when we are in trouble and distress, he likes us to think that we're the only people that are in trouble and distress. Like everybody else has it great. And it's just us who are in trouble and beleaguered and hard-pressed, angry, and sinful, and tired. I mean, that's the devil wants us to think, that we're the only ones like that, right? And you know what doesn't help, by the way, is social media, that we sit there and whenever I post up a whatever, that everything's filtered. So everybody's life, we get to see the very best of everybody else's life. And then, you know, I'm not gonna show you how messy my back seat is on Instagram. It's actually not that bad. Huh, I'll show you. It's like the cleanest it's ever been. Anyway, we get the best. So we think that everyone else just is killing it. It's got their life zipped up and things are falling apart for us. This is just not true. And if your life, look, the Bible was written for people whose lives are falling apart. The Bible is written for the Bible is written for the weary. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest, says Jesus. If you're not weary, you don't need this. It's those who are sick that need a physician, not those who are well. So the Bible's for the sick. Jesus came to be the Savior, which means that we need to be saved. that you need to be saved, that I need to be saved, that the person sitting next to you needs to be saved. Now you're looking at each other, huh? That your neighbor needs to be saved, that your enemy needs to be saved. All of us need a Savior. That's why Jesus came. Son of Man came to seek and save that which was lost. So if you're not weary, if you're not a sinner, if you're not lost, then Jesus, what? He doesn't. You don't need him. At least you don't know you need him. So it's good for us to see this Capernaum nobleman there in such distress, because it reminds us that the people then, just like the people now, are in distress. That we need rescue. That's not... I want to show you this guy on the motorcycle, but I'm not sure that he would like it. Let me try this covertly. Did you get a glimpse? this nice family over here and this dude over here equally need Jesus. So does this guy. And we have him. I mean, Jesus says to the man, your son will live. He says to us, you also will live. Your sins are forgiven. God be praised. Sunday drag home.